The sovereign integral process becomes a natural part of the life expression of the individual. If enough human beings can embrace this process, or something like it, the crack in the wall will expand, the wall will become less stable, and the world of separation, in its brittleness, will begin to crumble. The life essence is what we have on our side. This is not a slingshot as you put it. It is the infinite force that powers every object in the universe. Life is inside us, and it exists in one and only one state. Equality and oneness. The entire hologram of deception, as created and curated by the Anunnaki and their cohorts, that is not life, it is the exemplar of separation. Life is truthful and authentic. Separation begets deception, unworthiness and fear. If enough human beings awaken, if we begin to realize what's afoot, what plans are being made to further enslave us, and ensure that we remain a part of the hologram of deception, life will move inside us and we can collectively stand up and stop this, but it has to be done in the right way, with honesty, forgiveness and compassion. The alternative to separation must be expressed in our movements and practices. We have to model these behaviors as a collective entity. That is the definition of the grand portal.
You've talked a lot about separation. Can you elaborate on why this concept is so prevalent?
If you look at the material that comes from religion, spirituality, philosophy, psychology, even the arts, you will see that much of this material is designed to be an owner's manual for our functional implants. They support the human 2.0 interface. They instruct us on the methods and attitudes to activate these systems inside us. I've previously mentioned the three layers of the consciousness interface, the conscious mind, the subconscious and the unconscious. The unconscious is where we mostly operate in terms of our behaviors and perceptions. The unconscious mind layer is deep and penetrating, and it is universal. As I said, it's how Anu uses the oneness concept to his benefit. We are one in separation. The unconscious mind is one. Separation is a fractal energy. It infects everything within the hologram of deception to such a degree that it's not recognizable. No matter how well-intentioned a person or organization might be to convey true information, what often lurks behind the information is this fractal energy of separation, and its use of comparison and judgment, and all the other tools of separation, that distill down to fear and unworthiness. It's as if the internal programming of Marduk, and the external programming of the Triad of Power, echoes around in all content of all times and cultures, so common and accepted, as to be unnoticeable. We have accepted separation, because it seems normal. Thus our behaviors and perceptions, driven largely by the unconscious mind, embody separation, and the vast majority of us do not even know it.
Okay, but then how do we become aware of it?
A person must understand that they are being programmed. That's a starting point. If you don't accept this basic premise, then why would you choose to change? If you do, then observe the programming inside you, within others in your environment, the larger world, and begin to see how subtle this programming is. In many ways, to observe this programming requires us to be neutral, so we can simply observe our internal states and the messages therein, as well as those of the external program, which come via television, the internet, email, newspapers, magazines, direct mail, and so on. It isn't critical that you know how every program is expressed into your life or what its esoteric meaning is. What's important is that you understand you are being programmed and you seek an internal source of direction, inspiration and movement. The sovereign integral process is focused on you, the individual, directing your own self, life essence, to express itself in oneness and equality. That's it. If you do this, then you are releasing the hold of the programming. For some this can be done quickly, and for others it might require more diligent practice.
Can I do this and still be a Christian or whatever I was raised in?
I suggest that anyone who resonates with this information, try it out. See how it moves them through their life path. If they want to remain in their current structures, see if elements of the sovereign integral process could be applied. But if you don't see separation in your current practices, then stay there, because you won't have the motivation to be a practitioner.
But you just said that most of us don't see separation.
I said that if you don't see it in your current practice, then you won't be motivated to change. This process is all about change. Make no mistake about it. It is not selfish in any way. There is no burrowing into the bedrock of a belief system here that will make you feel superior, or privileged, or wise. There really is no belief system here, other than the sovereign integral process. There is no structure, no organization, no master, no hierarchy, no one is above another or below another. Do you see? This is not an organization of this world. It cannot be of this world. Otherwise it is subject to separation. The only way the human 3.0SA manifests is inside enough human beings who exemplify this process, who anchor this new consciousness of conduct on this planet, and share it through their behaviors and unconscious mind. That's the only way, and not everyone is prepared to do that.
What happens if we see separation, but still don't have the motivation to make the changes in our behaviors?
The functional implants of the human 2.0 interface are seldom easy to release. They will hold on to your life essence as long as they can. They want to drive the human vessel, not hop in the backseat and watch as mere passengers. That's against their program.
So talk about this resistance from the functional implants. How does it manifest?
I'm sure it's an individual thing. I don't pretend to know how it is for anyone else. I can tell you from personal experience that I initially dived headfirst into this process and rearranged my life. I thought I was doing a good job, and then a week or two later, I found myself back to square one, exactly where I'd started. It felt like amnesia. It was as if I had forgotten I was even doing a new practice. Admittedly, in my case, I had a lot of distractions in my life, but everyone can probably say the same thing. So I think this tendency to return to the habits of the consciousness system inside our 2.0 interface is the main way that resistance is expressed. Change of the scope is not an easy proposition. The human 2.0 mind doesn't like the backseat.
So what did you do to return to the sovereign integral process?
Well, for me, I needed to direct the techniques inward.
Explain what you mean.
I was directing the hard virtues outward to others, but I wasn't turning them inward to myself. It dawned on me that the inward was probably the most important place to start.
How did you do that?
It takes great alertness to live and express in the now. Human beings have a tendency to live in our past memories or future concerns. This was what I was doing, and it took me from the now. And the now is where our life essence expresses. It isn't in the past or future, only the consciousness framework pivots between past and future, so if you find yourself in there, you know you are not in your essence. When I realized this, I read from the Wingmaker's philosophy that breath was the magnet of nowness. It was the element that brought the human being into nowness by being aware of their breathing. I also learned that there were different kinds of breathing that enabled this sense of nowness to penetrate more vividly into the hologram of deception. The point is that simply being aware of my breath helped, as the Wingmakers put it, to center me in stillness. This, by the way, doesn't mean that you're in a quiet room. You can be in a meeting at work and center yourself in stillness through your breath. But by being in this internal centeredness, I was in a better position to feel my own sense of expression, and that's what was missing in my initial efforts to integrate this process. I didn't have a good starting point for my practice of the heart virtues, and I was directing them outward, to other people or events, and not myself first. Once I made that adjustment, it helped me to identify my essence and distinguish it from my mind system. Life essence is authentic in oneness and equality, and exclusively moves in nowness. The consciousness framework pivots between the past, present and future and operates in separation. If you express the heart virtues from the consciousness framework, especially outwardly, they won't have the same potency or effect.
You've mentioned the idea of resistive and insertive behaviors, and I think I understand the insertive behaviors in terms of expressing the heart virtues to oneself and others, but talk a little bit about the resistive behaviors. What are they, and how does that work?
Again, you need to start from the point of distinguishing your life essence in the now. Center yourself in nowness through being still and breath aware. Initially, this may take some time, but it happens quicker with practice. Thought patterns that connect you to separation need to be stopped. Behaviors, too. You can simply say, I've identified a behavior that supports separation in this world. Let's say I have believed that Muslims are less moral than atheists, and therefore less likely to get into heaven, than someone who doesn't even believe in God. This is a belief or thought form that relates to separation. I can say, stop that, but it's not really effective for most people. I can resist the belief every time it expresses itself in my life, but many of these beliefs are so subtle and subconscious that we don't even realize how they express themselves in our behaviors and choices. If you apply the hard virtues to yourself, like forgive yourself for having these perceptions, have some compassion for yourself that everyone is affected with these separation beliefs, from their subconscious and unconscious mind layers. Be humble that making this resistive alteration is not just about you, but in a way, it's about everyone, because we are one. Appreciate the fact that you are working on this for the good of all. Have valor that you can stand up and resist these separation complexes that lurk in your programmed consciousness framework. You can see how I used the hard virtues to effectively deal with a belief or perception that separated me, not just from Muslims, though they were the target in this particular example, but when you draw separation lines around anyone, you're operating from the consciousness system implant, and it only supports the hologram of deception.
Okay, but you're not suggesting that I look at rapists and murderers as one with me, are you?
Well, that's just it. They are. You can't have oneness and equality and then say, well, that's true, except for this population of society, or these felons of the human race. There is no leper colony, where humans are excluded outside of the circle. The circle is all-inclusive, or it is an illusion. This is an absolute. Remember my statement about the hologram of deception as a prison?
Yes.
There is no other prison inside the prison. We're all in the prison. All of us are prisoners, even those who are in the incunabula. There is no one who stands inside the prison walls and truly knows oneness and equality.
But then how does it change, if no one knows this?
It's a process, both for the individual and the human race. We work on it, together. We resist behaviors of separation, and insert behaviors of oneness and equality. We disengage from the thoughts, ideas, beliefs, principles, people, organizations, currencies, food, clothing, fashion, toys, and everything else within the hierarchy whose roots are nourished by separation.
When you put it that way, it sounds daunting, even impossible.
It has to be done, and it has to be done by us. The question is, if it has to be done, when does humanity want to do it? Now? 100 years? 1,000 years? 10,000 years? The wing makers are clear about this in their writings, that if we wait until after human 3.0, when man and machine become integrated, it will only become more difficult. Enslavement of life must end, at all levels.
I want to shift to something that's been bothering me about this whole conversation, and that is the issue of a god. From your description, God, as we've come to think of him, or her, or it, is an illusion. It's really a being who presents himself as God. So the question is there a real God?
Thanks for asking that question. I meant to bring it up on my own, and I think I sidetracked myself. Let's go back to the thought experiment about the bubbles. There is a presentation of a God, which as I've said, is Anu. This is the God that Muslim, Jew and Christian alike, revere and worship. This is the God who desires to return and provide a clear supremacy over humankind, to direct humanity to a human 3.0, one world transhumanist existence that would stretch into forever. As I have said, there's a life essence inside all beings, including the Anunnaki, and this life essence is infinite. If you understand infinite, then you understand it is outside of space-time. If a being is outside of space-time, it is not defined by polarities, like birth and death, creation and destruction, good and evil, and so forth. It is beholden to none of our vocabulary and concepts. Thus, when the wing makers decided it was time for this information to become available on Earth, it was offered, in terms of its text, as a bridge. In other words, it was decelerated to our language constructs.
And other forms of media, too, like the music and art.
Yes, but in a different application. All of this information needed to be encoded in a way that would be acceptable to two sources of scrutiny. One was Anu and his hierarchy, the other, the individual. Which is why the material in this interview will only be released when certain conditions are met, and the wingmakers are reasonably satisfied that the information will not be taken down by the hierarchy or dismissed as a fairy tale by the individuals they are trying to reach. Now, when this deceleration occurred, they elected to release the information in phases. Phase 1 would be encoded in a way that would allow people to understand the world outside of the hologram of deception, but in a framework that's somewhat familiar, that's resonant with the evolving beliefs on the planet. Hence, the idea of first source, source intelligence, sovereign integral, human instrument. All of these concepts will be provided without contextual details, because if they were included, the information that I'm telling you tonight would be purged by the hierarchy. The entire event string would be taken down. The inception point of the portal and grand portal would have been mired in doubt. So, it will be dispensed in the manner it must. This is not in my control. Source intelligence is the energy intelligence of first source that serves to accelerate the expansion of consciousness and supports those who desire to unlimit themselves.
What does this have to do with the existence of a god or not?
I just wanted to clarify that the word god means multiple things and it needs to be clear what meaning is being used. That's why, in part, the Wingmakers don't use the word god but instead use the word first source. However, in their later philosophical writings, after Chamber 6, they don't use this word, for the reasons I mentioned. But these are very subtle intonations in their writings, as they try to weave their messages into our modern-day culture without being targeted by hierarchical censors.
There are literally people who censor this information?
There are people who censor and control information everywhere, in the media, the government, the military, the sciences, education, religion, everywhere. The hierarchy has a complete army of censors. The vast majority don't know who they really work for, they're just enforcing what they've been hired to enforce. It's just a job. But technology platforms exist primarily for censorship. Intelligence gathering enables NSA censorship and information control. It's their job to filter, control and manipulate information. The system of mass surveillance isn't deployed to protect the masses. It's to control them, to keep them inside the prison, from a news perspective, and controllable, from the elite perspective.
You're not saying that the NSA cares about things like this, are you?
Not in the sense of how God is defined, but it's through their surveillance platforms that those in the hierarchy are alerted to information that details critical aspects of their hologram of deception. That kind of information is fed upstream to those who do care.
If that's the case, then whenever this gets released, it'll get censored. So what's the point?
This is all about timing. If this gets released, it will be because the Wingmakers have confidence that it will pass censorship. Something will have happened to enable it.
I'm aware you haven't really answered my question yet on God, so I do want to come back to that. But with the internet these days, couldn't you just drop this whole information on the public at one time? It'd go out to a few thousand people and then they could put it out on other sites and it would just grow in geometrical progression. How could they hold it back or censor it?
It would be modified. It's a complete set of information. Once it got out in that format, some would claim their version is the original and others would claim that their version was the original, and they might be as different as black and white in some areas. It only creates confusion, and once there's confusion, it's impossible to bring clarity. In intelligence circles, this is called reputation destruction. Think of it like this. You have a set of information that is targeted to specific beings that live everywhere on the planet. You wait until there is a communication system that can get to each of these beings. You have to make sure that the information is as pure as it can be, but still get past the sensors, so you encode it and release it in phases. The first phase is released as a real event, to test the waters of reaction. The second phase is released with new content and modifications, emphasizing that it's a mythology. This is to reassure the censors. The third phase will get more involved in practices and behaviors, but without full context. The fourth phase will probably be the human portal. The fifth phase will probably be this interview. And the phases that follow will depend on how this interview is received. So every release is being observed by both the hierarchy and the Wingmakers.
Okay, let's go back to the God discussion.
Yes, so, to answer your question, is there a God? There are many gods. Some beings present themselves as gods, and some beings manipulate others to such a degree that they become regarded as gods. And then there are collective intelligences that move between the quantum membranes and simulate godlike qualities of omniscience and omnipotence, but they are not gods in the sense of being the creator. There are even some beings that present themselves as God through a human channel. The view of the Wingmakers is that the oldest civilizations in the universe believe there is a creator, but that this creator, known in the Wingmakers' philosophy as first source, is so fundamental that it is the fractal essence of all life in all variations. It is the quantum zygote of life at the most foundational level. It is not truly knowable as we think of knowledge. It is experiential through sound that evokes this tone of equality spoken of in the Wingmakers' philosophy. It's not apprehended through the mind, which makes it hard to describe or convey. This is the problem with anything so elemental that it all but disappears. How do you convey it in such a way that it can hold a human being's attention?
So there's a God, but it's unapproachable. Is that basically it?
Yes, but I want to mention that the relationship is to a creator, not a God. The creator is in all life. God is more of a parent, and in religious circles, a father figure who is humanized to such a degree that we can pray to God to give us things, help us remove obstacles, crush our enemies and so on. Creator is aligned to oneness and equality, while God is aligned to separation and fear. First source is the creator of life, the manifest reality of all existence. The creator lives within life as the infinite spark that connects all life as equals in oneness. It is not here to be humanized. It cannot be humanized, or for that matter, reduced to any other life form or thing. The creator is the conjoining of all existence in the equality of oneness, and when that occurs, then God exists. When it does not, there is no God in existence, only a creator. It is really that simple. As it is said in various religious texts that God created man in his image or likeness. And provided you understand Anu as God, then this is a reasonably true statement. However, the creator created the infinite spark that animates the human form, and so the sovereign integral is the creation, and Anu had nothing to do with this. He merely figured out a way to enslave it. The last thing I'll say about the concept of God is that it's used by religions to separate ourselves from responsibility. It allows us to say, I'm not responsible for poverty, or war, or child abuse. There is a God who is much higher than us. God created the world, he is in charge. If he allows war and poverty, who am I to bear responsibility? The wrongdoers will pay in hell, and the tormented will reign in heaven. So God, or the concept of God, releases us from responsibility. The Creator, on the other hand, is not this way, because we're all bound in oneness, and what happens to one happens to all, and therefore, we're all responsible for allowing separation to rule our behaviors. It's important to recognize the difference between the constructs of Creator and God, especially within the hologram of deception.
After hearing all of this explanation, not just about God, Creator, but the whole interview tonight, why couldn't it have just been released as it is defined in this interview? Why even release the first phases if they lacked this context?
I've tried to answer this already, let me put it this way, but understand that this is speculation, so take it as such. There's no assurance that this will get released or stay released. That's one reason. There may be other individuals that need the earlier phase information because it bridges their current beliefs better than the later phase information. That's another reason. Remember, this is as much about redefining the unconscious mind as it is anything else. The unconscious mind is the back door that the Anunnaki left open in their designs. That's where the hacking vector can come in, and that's how the Wingmaker's information was brought in.
What do you mean by hacking vector?
The Wingmakers are hacking the program of our consciousness framework as designed by the Anunnaki, programmed internally in the DNA and functional implants by Marduk, and programmed externally by the Hierarchy, also known as the Illuminati, Globalists, New World Order Elite, Bilderberg Group, etc. The Wingmakers must come into these programs from vectors that are less protected or defended by sensors, and have the potential for quick spread. Bear in mind, that while the functional implants of the human 2.0 interface are programmable, should they become hacked or altered, they can be upgraded or patched just like software. So the ideal method to enter the human domain is to enter through a backdoor, appear harmless, even part of the order, and then quietly see the fractal process that can spread through the unconscious mind layer. That vector is not altering the program from the hardware or software perspective. It utilizes the consciousness framework in the human 2.0 interface without changing its programming. It's like an app riding on top of the operating system. It needs to be invisible until certain conditions are met. Once those conditions are met, it can be released, and once it is spread, it cannot be stopped.
I'm not familiar with the term app. What does it mean?
It's a software application that's not part of the OS, but uses the OS or operating system.
If it isn't changing the consciousness framework, then what's it doing?
It allows individuals to initiate their own sovereign integral process, which allows them to release the hold of these systems on their life essence. It's less about modifying or changing the program than it is about releasing the hold that these programs have on the consciousness of the life essence.
Okay, I think I understand, so I want to go back to this process. You said it has two main parts, insertive behaviors and resistive behaviors. You also mentioned something about breath, but I didn't hear you say anything specific about it.
Yes, the breath is an important way to bring you into self-awareness. It's like a quantum light turning on that illuminates your life essence, that part of you that is not of the human 2.0 interface. You're able to sense and begin to re-experience this infinite being that is you. The breath is something that anyone can use without a lot of complication, and obviously, it's always with you. It doesn't require any technology or expertise. It's really just a way to shift attention to the core of yourself. The Wing Makers write about quantum breathing or quantum pause. It's a technique from Philosophy 7.
Can you explain it?
It's very simple. You breathe in through your nose for about 2 to 4 seconds, or whatever's comfortable for you. Once you've filled your lungs, you pause, or hold your breath, for the same amount of time you breathe in. While you're in the pause, holding your breath, feel it like a suspension of time, and fill that space with the feeling of I am.
Okay, sorry to interrupt, but tell me again, what is the I am feeling? How do you define it?
It's the sovereign aspect of consciousness. It's not the personality that defines your human experience, or you typically associate with as yourself. It is the infinite consciousness of you. It is also one. I is one. It is one thing, infinite life. It is not the mind, nor the heart, nor the body, nor the feelings and emotions of the personality. It is singular in its depth and silence.
Okay, go on.
After you hold the breath in your lungs, and anchor it with the I am feeling, you exhale through your mouth, again for the same period of time, and then you pause again, your lungs are empty, and as you pause, you hold the feeling of we are. Then you repeat this cycle until you feel you're done.
Can you explain the we are feeling, too?
This is a sense of connection to all. The sense that you are connected, and that the I am feeling, you held a moment ago is being shared with all. I use the out-breath pause, to place any of the hard virtues that I'm working on at the time. For example, I might be working on the virtue of compassion in my personal life, and I can hold that feeling of that out-breath pause, and imagine it as being shared with all.
I think I understand what you're saying, and I don't want you to take this the wrong way, but how can this possibly compete with a globalist agenda of world takeover?
It's a fair question. But look at the reality. There are many who've protested this enslavement. Throughout history there have been people that have come to this realization through various means, and they alerted people to this deception. They may call it a conspiracy, without really understanding the depth of this deception, or its ultimate plan, but in whatever way they know of this, and at whatever level, they all experience fear. The fear is that we're powerless to stop them. The capstone of the elite have been planning this for more than 11,000 years, before human 2.0 even existed, the plot was devised. They have powerful interdimensional beings that know humanity on an intimate level, because they literally created the human being, and they can program humanity with such granularity as to define our life paths down to our day-to-day choices. How can one possibly defeat such an antagonist? They have the money, they have the politicians in their pockets, they have the defense and protection, they have the powerful relationships everywhere in the world, and they have the most powerful technology in terms of surveillance and weapons. Their innermost circle is impenetrable. We can be wide awake and aware of what's happening, but awareness doesn't suddenly, in itself, change the chessboard. They taunt us to protest. Wave your signs, publish your websites, fling your fists to the sky, investigate all you want, it won't change a thing. They will tell us to our faces that their power is inexhaustible. This is how they think. They want us to feel this futility and have this overriding sense that the endgame is unavoidable. They want us to believe that we are powerless. Remember, they are securing the world and its populations for the return of Anu. That is their program, and while only the capstone of the elite understands this plan, it is enough, because the downstream operatives are loyal, programmed entities. All one needs to do is to watch Madeleine Albright in that 60 Minutes interview, and you will understand how they have been programmed to think.
I don't think I saw that. What did she do?
About a year and a half ago, Leslie Stahl of 60 Minutes asked the U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, Madeleine Albright, if the death of 500,000 children was worth the price to essentially punish Saddam Hussein. Albright responded that it was. You see, this is the enemy that holds power. If they can justify killing children, they can do anything. The Waymakers have written that it isn't the protests that will change this enemy. If we shout at them and practice resistance with our guns in the street, they will only squash us. To bring their objective to a halt, we need to push down the wall, and we can do this by being practitioners of the sovereign integral process or anything similar. If human beings become self-aware, deprogrammed entities, who understand specifically how we have been enslaved and for what reason, we can collectively push down the wall that separates us from our true selves. This creates a chain reaction that affects everyone, including the capstone of the elite. The wall falls for them, too. It's using the consciousness of the life essence to reveal the human 2.0 consciousness as an invented reality. It's weaning from the hologram of deception to the reality that all life exists infinitely as equals in oneness.
Okay, but how do we know that we'll be successful against them?
We don't, other than what I said before, that the Waymakers are humans who have time traveled to share this sovereign integral framework. I realize this sounds like science fiction meets David and Goliath. I can appreciate that, but I'm explaining what I know as directly and honestly as I can describe it. If anyone hears this interview, assuming it's released sometime in the future, then you can decide for yourself if what I say stands up to your scrutiny. I would just caution some to consider the possibility that should you dismiss it, your reaction could be a programmed response. It is your consciousness framework that is sensing and responding. Consider this before you dismiss this information as fiction.
But how would a person know this? I find myself doubting this disclosure. I don't find it very plausible. As a journalist, I'm trained to be suspicious of sources, and as much information as you've shared with me, I find myself wondering how this is possible, and I haven't heard about it.
The hierarchy practices deception by controlling the buttons on the machine of absolute power. This machine is.
But you yourself said the internet was not something that they wanted to get out.
True, but whatever technology is released, they will find a way to use it to their advantage. It doesn't matter what the technology is, they will find a way to subvert it, modify it and use it for their agenda. These are extremely bright beings that are obsessed with the centralization of power and control, so that Anu can insert himself without resistance.
What if enough people woke up and rebelled? Couldn't we start a revolution and overthrow these crazy criminals?
They are not crazy. They are deceptive intelligences, who have lost all sense of connection to their true selves. In many ways, they are the ones who are lost, and because they are so lost, they have led the unsuspecting to their haze of obedience. We have followed them. That's our responsibility. The material is here, in this interview, to wake up. But it's one thing to wake up, and it's another thing to know what to do about it. You mentioned a revolution. According to the Waymakers, it would be a waste of life. They are not going to relinquish what they have worked so hard and long to produce. This will only change when the wall is pushed down. The wall is the human 2.0 consciousness framework that is programmed within every human being. The wall needs to be pushed down, and the way this occurs is not through protest, storming the gates, or shaking our collective fists in their face. It must be done through individual self-realization, and this, because of our programming, requires us to follow a process that enables us to become self-realized of our life essence. If we remain in separation, we can't solve the problem of separation. If we remain in deception, we can't reveal anything of our true nature. So we need to see all, as one and equal, in this hologram of deception, and that includes the capstone of the elite, as much as the poor and hungry.
I don't see how people will be able to do that. Maybe I'm a pessimist, I don't know, but will enough people really be able to do this?
At the heart of this whole situation is a single reality, and that reality, as hard as it may be to touch, is that we are infinite beings. Everything that is of space-time is within the hologram of deception. Everything. Which reality do you believe is more powerful and lasting?
Whatever is infinite.
Don't believe the programming that you are powerless. The sovereign integral process demonstrates that you are not merely a programmed life existence.
I feel I could go on with this conversation for another couple hours, but I also sense you're trying to close it up. How are you doing on time?
I can go a little longer if you have more questions.
I have lots of questions. How about if we take a short break and I'll take that time to review my notes, and then I'll try and keep my next set of questions to another 15 minutes or so. How does that sound?
Sure, that's fine.
Great, then we'll begin in 10 minutes. The tape is rolling again, and I've got my questions. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, good. Does it seem like a strange coincidence that the Labyrinth Group was trying to create time travel technology, and you stumbled upon the Wingmakers who are time travelers?
Not entirely.
But how do you really know that they're not aliens or some other non-human beings?
Sometimes you just have to take things at face value, when there's no evidence to the contrary, and no evidence that would support any reason for them to misrepresent themselves.
Through all of my discussions with you, this interview is like someone coming into my home and rearranging all the furniture. What advice do you have for anyone who reads this and gets a little paranoid or uneasy about this information, and what should they do about it?
This disclosure is not meant to frighten anyone or make them paranoid. It's meant to support them in their own awakening as infinite beings. That's really it. That's the information's purpose. This includes all of the Wingmakers' information in whatever form it's in. There's a core stability inside you that's been sidelined in favor of a manufactured or programmed response to life. You are programmed to fear, because then you will abdicate your liberties to your saviors. And who do you suppose your saviors will be? Who is it that makes Saddam Hussein out to be a monster, while they kill hundreds of thousands of children to prove their power is moral? The entities behind that power are the ones who will step forward and claim to save you. How they will do this is an unknown, but I have no doubt they will do it. And every time they do it, the corrals grow in number, and the populations inside the corrals swell in size. The fences get higher. Those who remain outside the corrals will think they have insight or special information that allows them to remain independent or free, but they're still operating inside their human 2.0 interface. The only real question, as I see it, has two parts. 1. Do I serve truth or deception? And 2. How do I best serve truth? If you feel that the best way to serve truth is to protest, resist, build awareness about what is happening in the world, then do that, but I would recommend doing it from a non-polarity perspective. You can't fight separation with more separation, it will only polarize. It's important to feel that you are standing up, not in fear, or some other programmed emotion, but that you are aligned to your life essence, and an expression of that source within you, even when you protest. Others may prefer to undergo the sovereign integral process and focus on this more internal stratagem. There is no formula here, and certainly you can do both. But to know this information and then remain passive, a pure observer, is a programmed response, and that is not an answer to, how do I best serve truth? It is a denial of truth.
You mentioned earlier that the Anunnaki lent their DNA to the human 2.0. It suggests then that their DNA would be present in a lot of us. Is that the case?
This is a very complicated subject. Yes, according to the Wingmakers, the Anunnaki, in an attempt to enhance human DNA, conducted what we would call today in vitro fertilization experiments with human women. They wanted their DNA to create a subspecies that could endure generationally to produce loyalists. The Syrians did the same thing. In terms of DNA tendencies, the Anunnaki were conquerors and the Syrian progeny were colonists. That's being very general, admittedly, but in broad terms that was the nature of their bloodlines, when compared to their human counterparts. The DNA template for human 2.0 was Anunnaki, but it had been altered. This is where the subject gets complicated. The Anunnaki are not physical beings. They did not exist in three-dimensional density as we know it today. The Earth, 500,000 years ago, was a very different place, in terms of its density, and the gravitational fields that bathed it. The Anunnaki were interdimensional beings, meaning they are infinite just as we are, but without the physical body. However, all beings possess DNA. It's the quantum equivalent of a blueprint. So they experimented with how to use their DNA to create physical beings that could function in accordance to their agenda, which, as I said, was initially mining gold, but later turned to the enslavement of a species who would worship Anu. When the Anunnaki fertilized human women, it was with royal bloodlines, and this was not a coincidence. They wanted these royal bloodlines to sustain over thousands of generations so they could more easily facilitate their master plans on Earth.
Was this a nationalistic thing?
How do you mean that?
Were Anunnaki bloodlines mostly Arab, Jewish, or Gentile? Were there certain characteristics that were noticeable in the physical body?
The Anunnaki bloodlines were initially Babylonian and Egyptian, but they have spread into nearly all races. It probably wouldn't be an overstatement to say that nearly every person on the planet today has some fractional percentage of Anunnaki royal DNA.
What were they, in terms of their look? I assume they look like us.
Yes. It was Atlantean, Anunnaki and Sirian body styles that were effectively blended to create the human 1.0 prototype. All of these beings, though less dense, looked similar to a human form. Races did not intermingle, as they were very cautious not to intermix their DNA, because they were uncertain of the effect and how it might pollute or mutate through their genetics. But remember, the human physical body was an experiment, and they literally looked at it as physical protection, just like we would look at a spacesuit. None of these races lived in the density of Earth, or an Earth-like planet. They didn't realize how Earth would interact with their creation and cause it to evolve in directions that they couldn't control or predict. Earth, as I previously said, was like a random variable, imposing itself on the human body through its gravitational fields. The interbreeding between Anunnaki and human women took place around 6000 BCE, and it was a designed event, not some lustful dalliance with the daughters of men, as it is sometimes portrayed in Sumerian texts. This was part of a design to place a subspecies within the human race that would conquer and control the Earth's resources. It was to consolidate and centralize resources for Anu, and to ensure that the world's wealth could be placed into his waiting hands when he returned.
The whole thing about LERM, light-encoded reality matrix, and how the Labyrinth group had seen it as God, I don't understand that if 15 had read the same information as you, how he wouldn't have come to the same conclusions as you. I know you mentioned that you had additional contacts with the Wingmakers, and this convinced you of the authenticity of the information, but why do you think 15 clung to his perspective?
You can look at LERM as the connection between the Earth plane and the non-physical planes of the hologram that Anu constructed inside our functional implants. LERM was the connective web, and it was bidirectional, meaning that Anu could be projected into any being's consciousness framework to be seen or heard, and it also meant that Anu could detect and view into the life of an individual being. LERM is known as the White Light, and the Great White Brotherhood is known as its guardians. They appropriated Jesus and Buddha as their foundational pillars, stole the concept of I Am, matched these elements with the White Light, that had been a factor in every religious, occult and esoteric doctrine throughout time, and announced in the 1950s that the Great White Brotherhood was a real organization. Soon after that, ascended masters began to join the swelling ranks, as human channelers began to be the spokespeople of these entities. From the Wingmaker's perspective, these entities are fixtures of the polarity plan to keep human beings firmly anchored in separation, distraction and deception.
What does this have to do with 15's decision?
Sorry, I got a little sidetracked. 15 knew of the Great White Brotherhood. It's considered a very important element in the overall hierarchy, very near the capstone of the elite or what I earlier called the Incunabula. The Great White Brotherhood was seen as a means to bring occult or secret information to the planet, and it was designed to balance the movement of secularization, which was to essentially rid the planet of religion and bring science to the stage. 15 was not sufficiently convinced to make a break from the Incunabula and the Great White Brotherhood. He preferred to view LERM as proof of God and leave his world intact. This is not, by the way, an uncommon reaction to this information. And intellects, as brilliant as 15's, will make this choice to stay in the known world instead of venture into the unknown. In 15's case, he had too much to lose.
Why did the elite want to get rid of religion?
First, I want to correct you on your choice of words. It isn't the elite, as most people think of them. The vast majority of the elite are corporate citizens, financial managers, government managers, political heavyweights, military commanders and the like. They are not making these decisions. The vast majority have no idea who or what the agenda is. That's why I refer to it as the capstone of the elite. These are ones who have been preparing the world for Anu's return. Now, back to your question, religion was seen as an obstacle to the One World Order. The quantum world of science was flexing its muscles, disproving key elements of religious doctrine, and it would, if left unmanaged, verify the hologram, but not the deception. The Great White Brotherhood was launched to the public in the 1950s, just as the quantum world was beginning to signal its stature, but it goes back to the 18th century when it was referred to as the Council of Light, and even before that it was a concept held in many secret societies. The idea of ascended masters, communicating with one another telepathically, and instructing and guiding the affairs of men, gained some popularity with those who were disenchanted with organized religion. To be fair, some of the channeled information did come from beings that were considerably more informed than the average man, and they could bedazzle most people with their superior knowledge of the cosmological order and the structure of things relative to God, but their description and explanation was founded in the hologram of deception, while these masters supposedly channeled the secret or hidden knowledge to their selected students, who then wrote books and created organizations. This information continued to separate the worlds of light and dark, good and evil, and those in the know from those who were not. They use words like love, ascension, truth, and God more liberally than organized religions, and God was always portrayed as a loving, congealing force. Angels and cosmic beings were also associated with these organizations. They not only appropriated symbols and constructs like the soul and eternal life, but they also created the ladder of consciousness that stretched into infinity, in which the student was forever trying to learn more to progress higher on the ladder. The elevation of one over another. This was the key concept of the separation tactic of the Great White Brotherhood and, frankly, all secret societies. Create divisions of knowledge, add a ritual or two, and promise more power and awareness as you, the student, walk the path. They don't talk about how to deprogram from separation, instead they reinforce it.
You've shared information in previous interviews about the central race. In my notes, you even said they were responsible for our DNA. Are they the Anunnaki?
No. No, you have to define DNA in two ways. One is the human instrument or body, emotions and mind system, and that stems from one system of DNA, courtesy of the Anunnaki and Syrians mostly. The second is the infinite being inside the human instrument, which is also based on DNA, which is the quantum blueprint of the sovereign integral consciousness. The latter is the DNA developed by the central race.
In the second interview, you made some pretty big claims about the seven sights of the Wingmakers being a defensive weapon, and that this somehow related to the individual's experience of the Wingmakers' materials. In light of this disclosure tonight, can you explain how this works?
The entire import of the Wingmakers' disclosure is about the sovereign integral, and how humanity benefits when the state of consciousness is seated within the human expression. The requirement to keep this disclosure in the realm of science fiction and mythology was why I mentioned this defensive weapon.
So you're saying this was just a story?
That part was. You see, the Wingmakers' materials are, by design, composed of many strands of information. Some strands are storytelling, some are artistic, some are spiritual, some are conspiratorial, and some are designed to be factual, coherent disclosures of what is really happening in our world. The strands of the storytelling encase the other strands, in a way, they shield these inner strands. I've already explained why it happened this way, and while some might feel it would be easier to just give the facts, if these facts were disclosed now, you would not have seen, heard or read this information. The Wingmakers' materials would have been censored or taken down and discredited. I'm sure there'll be a good dose of that anyway, when and if this interview is released, but the story strand was necessary to provide an acceptable container to release the sovereign integral process.
But this concerns me that the information you've provided in the previous four interviews is created, at least in part, as a story. How do I present it to any reliable news source as true?
You can't.
So then what do I do with it?
Either you will release it as a story, or I will. If you prefer not to, I understand.
Couldn't you just tell me what parts are story, and what parts are true?
I could, but this isn't how I've been asked to release the information.
But I've invested a lot of time in this already, and if I invest my reputation as well, then I need to focus on the true parts. Otherwise, I can't substantiate anything when I'm asked if, in my opinion, it's a true story.
Everyone wants to know the absolute truth. They want someone to point to this phrase, or that precept, or that doctrine and explain to them that that is truth. Believe it. That's been the game on this planet ever since humans begin to contemplate their universe in a philosophical manner. All the shared truth has gotten us where? Where we kill children to punish leaders. Where leaders lock people up in death camps. Where religious leaders abuse children. So I would ask you, what is the value of the information that has collectively brought humanity here? You want the signposts of truth. No one can do that, and your proof is that no one has.
Why?
Because we are sovereign and we must experience ourselves in this way, and not let others decide what it is we should or shouldn't believe, or what is truth or falsehood. I wish we didn't live in a hologram of deception, but that is our human reality, and whining about it will not change it one iota. Studying the supposed masters of truth will not change it either. I can show you a library of books that expound on esoteric information. Some of these books were written as non-fiction, and by all appearances they seem to be credible and insightful, and yet if you listen carefully to the words, you see how they are separating you from one another. How they define a hierarchy. How they define a soul that is always learning, a human that is always sinning and weak. How they describe a universe that is infinitely layered. How the light illuminates those who follow certain practices. It can be very subtle. They can be talking about oneness, but there are judgments present in the words, or recriminations if you don't execute the practice properly, or suggestions that you don't mix this practice with anything else or it is diminished, or join and promote this path over that one. Part of the sovereign integral process is to practice your discernment of what enables you to believe in you, not the universe or some master or teaching, but you, stripped bare of all of your add-ons, beliefs, thought patterns, fears, guilt, stories, judgments, blames, pretenses, everything that hangs on you from the past. If you could drop them all, everything you had been taught and told and programmed to believe, what would be left to hear? Silence. Deep, clear silence. That is you. When you find that, you will then know that everyone has that, too. Anu does, Lucifer does, Jesus does, your neighbor does, your spouse does. Everyone. So what proof do you need to find that? What proof can I show you or tell you to give you that? I can't. I can convey a process that if you follow it, you might find this experience inside you, but that's all. The process is free, it only requires time. The process is not owned by anyone. The process is not part of anything but you. Once you stand at the trailhead of that process, it's yours to follow or reject. Everyone must achieve this realization of oneness and equality in life on Earth. That is our call to action as a species. And in my opinion, anyone or anything that tells you otherwise is lost. One more thing, the story strand may be exactly what activates someone to the sovereign integral process, and I think that was the point that the Wingmakers took with their information. Everything about their work is signaling the individual to the sovereign integral process, and the realization of the grand portal.
If Anu is what we have been taught as God, then who is Lucifer?
It is precisely for this reason that you have to be sovereign. Because in the world where Anu is God, it is easy to presume that Lucifer is the real bearer of light. But remember what I've said over and over, everyone is lost in this hologram of deception. If all are lost, how can anyone lead you to truth? They can't. The truth is self-expression of your infinite self, in the human form upon Earth. That is the closest definition of truth that I know. It may not be the same for you or whoever reads this in the future, but this is my definition of truth. Does Lucifer advocate this? I'm not aware that he does. If anyone is not supporting my truth objective, then why would I let them move me in any other direction, even an inch? You ask who Lucifer is. There are a thousand ways to answer that question, several of them I already have. To add another definition, he is not a polarity of Anu or his puppet. At a fundamental level he lives in equality and oneness, the same as we. Is he awakened? I don't know. I haven't met him. I haven't talked with him. If I do, my first question of him will be, does he support the freedom of human beings, the kind I have just defined, and if he says yes, then I will accept his word until I see evidence to the contrary. If he says no, I will remove myself from his presence. If he says maybe, I would have a conversation with him and invite him to support this movement. Everyone is waking up. I realize it seems like the activation is in super slow motion, but in 70 to 80 years, a huge shift can occur in humanity's realization of what is really happening in this world. There is no way to hide this. It's already in the unconscious mind layer, and it will continue to spill out until we push the wall down.
This is more a comment or observation than a question, but the sovereign integral process seems existential instead of transcendental. It also seems like a solo journey instead of an organized group who are supporting one another. Is my perception accurate?
Partly, yes. I think the sovereign aspect is what you're picking up on. It's an internal process for the individual to develop within themselves, but the integral aspect is a collective, and I don't mean that as an organizational structure. This process needs to be outside of any organization's or individual's hands. It's not possible to own this or control it within an organizational structure. I think people can use the internet and email to support one another. Some will want this kind of support. Others may prefer to be left on their own. Relative to it being existential, yes, it is that. This isn't about ascending into the high places of heaven and hanging out in perfected realms of space, while your fellow human beings are lost, enslaved and corralled into ever-tightening spaces. This is about sharing the hard virtues and the truth of existence in your behaviors, here, on Earth. It is about making Earth a place where human beings can express their life essence, without the interference of unused hardware and market software, and to tear down the external programming that creates the parents of fear and separation, and all of their children attributes, like narcissism and hatred.
If I decide to release this information, do I have to practice it?
No.
Can I have some time to think about this?
How long do you need?
Maybe a week.
Of course, you can take more if you need it.
Are you resigned to the idea that you'll be caught?
I'm a realist. I don't think the ACIO will do anything rash. They'll simply do their best to quarantine me.
What does that mean?
I'll end up in a holding cell, off the grid.
What about Anu?
Anu is simply a name of the royal leader of the Anunnaki race. His name is symbolic of more than one being, which is the capstone of the elite. You could also look at Anu as the programmed existence of the human race. He exists in everyone to some degree. Anu's presentation of himself is that he's omniscient and omnipresent, and this is true in a certain way, so I have to deal with that reality. Everyone who wakes up and practices this process will meet this resistance in some form or other.
But if people hear that they will have to deal with Anu, won't they run from this? Who's going to try and fight that machine?
From the Wingmaker's perspective, thousands, and then hundreds of thousands, and then millions. The wall can collapse in an instant, when a critical mass is achieved.
But won't this be accompanied with hysteria and panic? At one time I thought the Grand Portal was a technological discovery of the soul, and it would be on the internet for all to see and experience in the comfort of their homes. But this isn't like that, is it?
No, this is more like a collapse of reality on a mass scale, where infinite beings suddenly find themselves awake inside a human uniform, and wonder what just happened.
What if it doesn't happen? What if they win, and Transhumanism 3.0 is the new human being locked into a world of separatism? What then?
I don't know how to answer that question, other than to say that the information provided by the Wingmakers is a new inception point, which necessarily means a new path. Maybe it will take more time, but it will happen. It has to. We're infinite beings, and this fact cannot be bottled up indefinitely.
I understand, but the whole concept of infinite beings, that's been around a long time. Soul has been around a long time as a concept. How is this any different?
Yes. It's been around a long time, but it's been bottled up into three paths. 1. Reincarnation and karma. 2. Be good and obedient and join the ranks of heaven. And 3. Ascend to a higher plane of existence and eventually become a teacher within the hierarchy. The fourth path, though not about soul, is that we are simply human flesh and blood and we have no soul. A person's soul is construed from one of these paths, assuming you believe you are a soul. Each of these paths, as I have already said, is within the hologram of deception. They do not lead outside, past the wall, and they certainly do not make the wall less stable. To be self-realized, as an infinite being, within a human body on Earth, decoupled from the controlling human 2.0 interface, is the fifth way. We've been living in a game show that has four doors, where an announcer keeps repeating the instruction, choose one of the four doors, while completely ignoring that there is a fifth door. This new inception point inserts the fifth door option. That's how it's different.
I wish I could go on with question after question, but I think this is probably a good place to stop.
I agree, Sarah.
Okay, good. Then we'll bring this to a close, but before we do, I'll give you the last word.
Well, first, thanks for your open-mindedness these past 2 weeks. Your questions were good guides, and for all your modesty, you grasped this information with great naturalness, which gave me permission to open up. You've served well those who will hear this, so on their behalf, thank you. I feel that I've given everything I was asked to provide. I realize I fumbled around at the start of this interview. I wasn't sure how to bring this out. I also know that some will want more information, but the critical material is here, in this interview. I'm sure there are more details and nuances I could have provided, but then, no matter how much detail I disclose, it would never be enough for some people. This is all about action and behavior, not reading or soaking up information from another person. The glimpse I provided is a good start, and that's all that's really needed for an inception point. I realize this may seem like a fantastical journey of fictional characters and unlikely events, not to be taken too seriously, but in my view, this disclosure of the Wingmakers is their most important.
Thank you, Dr. Neruda.
What is within us was present before the universe was created. Our inner, pre-quantum core existed previous to space-time, before any extra-dimensional race enslaved us. We are not weak or defenseless. We are not mere human beings with 80-year lifespans. We are infinite, and we are all that is needed to transform reality so that each of us serves truth, because we see truth. Earth is not a playground or a schoolroom, any more than we are gullible children. There is no new age or end time. There is only the infinite platform upon which we all belong, where we rise up as sovereign integrals upon Earth. James Matt.